Now that you've made it as a remote developer, what do you need to go that extra mile? Hi, my name's Ting. I'm a remote front-end developer here at Arc. In this video, we're going to go over 4 tips to ensure your success as a remote developer. On-site and remote may only seem to differ in where we work. However, don't let that fool you. Simply copying and pasting the way of on-site into remote work would not work. There are aspects of remote that need alternative methods to be tackled with. For instance, when developers move to remote, sometimes you lose out on a lot of the development-related water cooler talk. What this translates into is opportunity lost with experimental technical projects or just opportunities to spitball ideas back and forth. These are the talks that organically occur from when you're walking with your teammates to go buy lunch or, you know, when you're just making your morning pot of coffee. Unlike on-site, with remote, when you're paying someone to discuss an issue at hand, there's that inherent understanding that you need to have a more formulated thought process rather than, hey, what do you think about XYZ?
I don't know.
While it's great that you're gaining back time from the lack of commute, you have to be careful about your home and work boundaries, because if not, you might risk facing burnout from an endless grind. So with these potential issues in mind, let's jump into 4 tips to ensure your success as a remote developer. Tip number 1, you need a routine to maintain clear boundaries between work and life. Because if you don't, you're gonna find yourself constantly working from the moment you wake up to the moment you sleep. This creates a negative cycle that leads to an endless grind and just a negative mental health. Unlike on-site, there's clear boundaries. When you're at the office, you're at work. When you're home, it's time to unwind and relax. However, when transitioning to remote, work and life happens in the same location, in your home. This makes it hard for the human brain to comprehend when it's time to switch off and rest. You can start off with defining your physical work locations and the rest of the home. That way, your brain can register when you're in the office, it's time for work. When you leave your office den, you know, it's time to switch off and relax. Aside from physical locations, you'll want to create rituals to start your day and end your day. This way, it signals to your brain when it's time to start and end, when to get into that scope of work, when to really turn off the mind and relax. For instance, start off your day with a 5-10 minute walk around the block, grab that extra coffee right before work starts, because getting your daily dose of sunshine in will boost your serotonin levels, which helps increase your focus state and a state of calmness. Remember, the brain only has so much capacity. So by having a sign on and sign off ritual for work, you're able to signal to the mind when you're able to sign off and recharge for the new day ahead. While it sounds simple, it's important to be intentional about the time you spend. Tip number 2, document, document, document. Documentation will be your team's best friend when you're remote. When co-located, you can simply pull up a chair next to another developer and ask details about a project. That's not the case when you're remote. Sometimes you might be facing teammates that are cross time zones. This means you might need to wait 10 hours plus for a response. This is not sustainable and it becomes a bottleneck in the process. Plus, it's super helpful to have documentation to look back onto to remind you of certain architectural decisions that were made at the time. Because let's be real, nobody remembers the code that they've written 3 months ago. Not only would this benefit remote teammates, but it's helpful to not lose that valuable domain product knowledge when you have turnover within the team. Simply documenting is not enough. You need to have a proper system in place to ensure your teammates know where to find the information and how to use it. Otherwise, this information quickly becomes obsolete when people don't know how to find it or nor how to use it. This was an issue that the Arc engineering team was actually facing. We had information spread across GitHub and Notion. However, teammates didn't know where to find the information they needed. As we had existing information, we couldn't simply migrate from one platform to another. And plus, each platform had their strengths and weaknesses in terms of demonstrating and showing the information. Given these constraints, we had assessed the following factors to assess which platform to use for certain topics. These included frequency of change, ease of change, is this tool already built into the developer's existing workflow, and the expiry timeline on the documentation, or did we need version control? Between Notion and GitHub, we had deemed that Notion was easier in updating, especially if documentation that was more frequent into change, just anything that had a shorter lifespan. These would include process reviews, meeting minutes, retros on features, or onboarding materials. Whereas with GitHub, we had dedicated it to more stable and constant information. These include development guidelines, process guidelines, and just front-end, back-end architecture. While there are many collaboration tools out there like GitHub, Notion, Google Docs, and so on, utilize these tools to their strengths. But remember to have one central location that acts as a directory connecting all the information. Tip number three, you need the right tools to support a remote collaborative development. It sounds like it should be pretty easy to find the right tools for the job, but is it? Having the right tools improves the remote development experience by supporting the necessary collaboration. Take pair programming, for instance. It's known for its wide variety of benefits, ranging from a better method of onboarding, a great way to share knowledge, and just higher code quality in general. When pairing co-located, a developer would pull up their chair next to another with their keyboard in hand, and you'll take turns alternating, driving the session. On the other hand, when transitioning to remote, generally, video conferencing tools are used for their remote access, screen sharing, and the video. The Arc engineering team has tried that. We've tried Zoom, Google Meets, Around, we've tried them all. However, there's one major pitfall. Think about this. Every developer, you have your own shortcuts, your keyboard shortcuts, customized shortcuts. All these speed up your own development process. However, this is something that most video conferencing tools aren't able to capture. Video conferencing tools were not built for the sole purpose of pair programming. So while using it, it works, but it may actually hinder the whole development experience when using it. This is why finding the right tools for a task is important in bettering the remote development experience, especially when you're collaborating together. My personal favorite is Tuple. It was built by developers for developers. It's a tool dedicated for pair programming. All inclusive, you have your keyboard shortcuts. They've built it specifically so that there isn't that annoying lag that we sometimes get when we're also doing screen sharing and remote control. Or an alternate is there's a lot of extensions on code editors. For instance, we have Teletype for Atom and LiveShare for VS Code. Tip number four, don't forget your coffee chats. When working remotely, informal communications are often overlooked. These are the conversations about anything other than work. And this is essential towards increasing trust, boosting team morale, and in turn, productivity. Think about this. When you're co-located, there's more opportunity for these conversations to happen naturally. Whether you're passing each other in the hallways, or you're walking out for lunch together, or just making your morning pot of coffee by the kitchen. These are the small moments that foster the relationships at work, whether it's celebrating your teammate's kid's first soccer win, or sharing that new pumpkin pie recipe you recently just learned. However, when switching to remote, these informal conversations often disappear if we are not intentional about planning for them. Coffee chats are a way to devote time to fostering friendship over non-work topics with your teammates. To sum up this video, we've covered the four tips to help you succeed as a remote developer. Tip number one, set a routine because it's hard to be productive when you're not feeling your best. Tip number two, documentation will be your team's best friend to close the knowledge gap within remote teams. Tip number three, find the right tools to support remote collaboration to improve your remote development experience. And finally, tip number four, don't forget coffee chats with your teammates to create trust and boost team morale. That's all for today, guys. Let me know in the comments below what are some of your top tips for succeeding as a remote developer. Thank you so much for watching. If you like the content, don't forget to give us a thumbs up, subscribe, and smash that bell to get notified of new content. Catch you next time. Bye.